Hello and welcome to this webinar titled Mass Spectrometry, an essential tool for characterization of monoclonal antibodies during development, hosted by BioPharma Asia magazine and presented by Dr. Wei Xu and Dr. Henry Shion. My name is Sri Patel and I will be the moderator. Before we begin, I would just like to remind our viewers that this event will be hosting a live question and answer session at the end of the presentation. You can submit a question at any time throughout the presentation via the questions tab located at the top of your screen, and we will go through these at the end of the presentation. Now please allow me to introduce you to our first presenter. Dr. Wei Xu is a principal scientist in analytical method development at Merck Research Laboratories. He's an expert in characterization of therapeutic proteins using analytical methods based on mass spectrometry, UPLC, and CE. Dr. Xu has more than 10 years' experience in characterization of monoclonal antibodies and other proteins while working in Merck, Regeneron, and legacy Schering-Plough. Prior to that, he worked on the characterization of cannabinoid receptor 1. Dr. Xu received his PhD in pharmaceutical sciences and MS in statistics from the University of Connecticut. Our second presenter, Dr. Henry Shion, is a principal scientist working in the global marketing division of Waters Corp. He has more than 15 years hands-on mass spectrometry experience for both biopharmaceutical and small molecule applications. He's currently focused on developing LC-MS-based analytical solutions for routine characterization and quantification of biotherapeutics, such as monoclonal antibodies, biosimilars, and antibody drug conjugates. Henry has published more than 15 peer-reviewed papers in various scientific subjects. He obtained his PhD from Drexel University in 1997 and carried out a postdoc training at University of Illinois College of Pharmacy under Dr. Richard Van Breemen before joining Waters in late 1998. I'd now like to invite our first presenter, Dr. Wei Xu, to join our webinar. Welcome, Dr. Xu.
Thank you for the introduction. Hello, everyone. Welcome to today's webinar. As I mentioned, the topic for my part is mass spectrometry, an external tool for characterization of monoclonal antibodies during development. So I will start with a brief introduction about why biological spectrometry and the general strategy for characterization during development. Then I will use some examples to show how mass spec was applicable to characterize the monoclonal antibody during development. At the end, I will have a brief conclusion. After that, I will pass the presentation to Dr. Shion, and he will continue his part. So let's look at some recent data. Back in 2012, the sales of biologicals almost doubled compared to 2006 and reached $124.6 billion. There are 33 blockbuster biologicals, and among them, antibody accounted more than half of the total biological sales. The top 10 best-selling drugs in 2013, each of them have more than $5.5 billion sales. Seven of them are biologicals. Moreover, the top three, Humira, Imbro, and Remicade, are monoclonal antibody and fusion proteins. It's worth to point out all three are targeting the TNF. Although in 2010, the biosimilar sales only about $0.2 billion, but by year 2020, which is around the corner, there are more than $67 billion for biological products pending will expire. So there's a big market. So biologicals can make profits. This is because biological simply works and it has less side effects. However, on the other side, there's many challenges in developing biologicals. From the analytical side, larger proteins such as monoclonal antibodies have more sources of heterogeneity than small molecules. For example, the N-terminal and C-terminal heterogeneity, glycosylation, glycation, apparently the amidation and osmolarization, as well as oxidation, diazepam bond, isomers, cleavage of the sequence generated fragments, also aggregations and conformational isomers. all these are multiple sources and complicated the analysis. So the quality by design paradigm is scientifically a sound approach for method development for biologicals and has been endorsed by regulatory authorities. So in the five stages of the QPD process, analytical plays a critical role here. So improved product and process understanding and process control will lead a superior product that will ultimately help improve public health and also benefit the business. Now let's take a look at some of the regulatory guidelines for the analytical strategy. So first one is intensive characterization is performed in the developer phase and where necessary following significant process changes. The second one is about new technology. So new analytical technology and modification to existing technology are continually being developed and should be utilized when appropriate. The third example I present here is about biosimilars. This will intensively characterize the proposed product and the reference product with the state-of-the-art technology because the analytical portion serves as the foundation for demonstration of biosimilarity. So orthogonal methods are required to characterize the full range of quality attributes for biologicals. This is including molecular weight, the charge profile, primary structure, and high order structures, as well as the impurities and the variants, affinity and efficacy. Often we need to apply more than one method to test each quality attribute. So the classical, typical the CE and LC-based method characterize monoclonal antibodies at global protein levels. Recent years, the traditional FDF page and IF gel have been replaced by CE-FDF and imaging CIF or CIF technologies. Also for the regular SPLC acids, now starting to move to the UPLC side because of its improved resolution and speed. This newer separation method, when combined with the mass spec, can characterize several proteins both at the global protein level as well as down to the residue level. So reverse phase LC-MS have been widely used in traditional. In my later examples, I'm going also to show some examples using SEC-MS and Helix-MS. CE shouldn't have been difficult to directly couple with the mass spec, but recently the interface development makes this very promising. The CESI-MS is the fifth interface with the mass spec, greatly improves the sensitivity of the mass spec analysis. This helps characterize the peaks identified in CE. Another example is active change mass spec. This technology helps characterize the conformation or three-dimensional structure of molecules. Due to its excellent specificity, resolution, and sensitivity, mass spec has been applied in all stages of the bioprocess development. It's including the cell line upstream process, downstream process, as well as the drug product development. For example, in the cell line upstream process, mass spec has been widely applied to confirm the master sequence of the expressed protein, characterize terminal heterogeneity, as well as the fragment data sequence, characterize glycosylation profile. It also helps characterize the media and process-related impurities, such as whole cell proteins. In the downstream process and the drug product development, mass spec is important in doing extensive characterization of stability sample, for stagnation samples, elucidating the degradation pathway of the therapeutic proteins, as well as help develop a properly formulation for the product. So in the first example, I'm going to show how mass spec helps identify a mutation in a monoclonal antibody. So the slide show here is a deconvoluted mass graph of the reduced antibody. The top panel here shows the light chain mass graph. The measured molecular weight matched very well with the calculated value. However, for the heavy chain, about one-third of the molecules is 76 times smaller than the calculated value from the sequence. So this indicating there might be a mutation on the heavy chain sequence. Then we examined the peptide matching data and able to locate a peptide which contains torsion to serine mutation. Based on the peak area of the mutated peptide from percentage is about 30% of the total. So this data matched very well with the reduced results. And the MSMS closely confirmed the mutation is torsion to serine in this peptide. However, from this data, we're still not sure each molecule, whether it have one mutation or two mutations on the two heavy chains. To solve this question, we need to look at the intact LCMS data. So the slides on the screen here showed it's the intact LCMS analysis of the sample. The top panel is the raw spectrum, and the bottom one is the deconvoluted one. So it's, I highlighted here, about 50% of the molecular only have one of the heavy chains carrying the mutation, and the other heavy chain is normal. There's about 10% of molecular have both heavy chain mutated. So this data was also further confirmed by gene sequencing. The cell received two copies of heavy chain genes and made a hybrid molecule. So the second example is use a mass spec to characterize the C-terminal heterogeneity. So classical LC or CE-based method, as I mentioned earlier, is characterize the protein's maps on the global protein level. So the top panel show here is a zoomed-in SEC chromatograms. The blue trace is a reference sample, and the red trace is a new sample. So from here, we can see the two samples are very comparable in terms of size profiles. The bottom panel is zoomed in kinetic intrinsic photographs. The same sample was analyzed, but I labeled them in the reverse color. So the blue trace is a new material, and the reference is labeled in red color. This is a zoomed in chromatograms. In terms of the number, the difference between the two samples in their acidic variance, the mean and basic variance is less than 2%. So based on this data, we can calculate that the two materials are comparable in terms of size and target profiles. However, when I analyze the same sample using reduced FMS, the data revealed in the new material, there's a new peak as I highlighted here on the downside or left side bottom panel. The new material have more variance carrying the C-terminal lysine. But from theoretically, the C-terminal lysine variance will elucidate the basic variance. Based on the difference between the two samples in the reduced LCMS analysis, we should see a significant difference in the target profile. However, in the previous slide I showed, the CX profile of the two samples are very comparable. So the two sets of data are conflicting. Fortunately, we also have the pattern matching result. So this data actually solved the puzzle. Indeed, the pattern matching result confirmed that the new material, which labeled here as GS2, contains about 6% higher C-terminal lysine variance compared to the reference. But on the other hand, the pattern matching result also showed this new material have about 8% less C-terminal LAMAD variance. So these two variants, they are co-located in the CEX as basic variance. So the sum of these two variants between the new material and reference is about 1.5% difference. That matched well with the CEX results. In the third example, I'm going to use some data to show how we characterize the glycosylation of MAPS. This example is a fusion protein produced by recombinant DNA technology. The molecule has three N-glycosylation sites. So the first strategy is we use the traditional UPLC helix fluorescence analysis of released glycans after 2-EB labeling. The analysis will provide us with the results that support the total in glycosylation from the three sites. The second strategy is to use the RDS digestion, then separate the FC glycosylation site from the other two sites and analyze the sample using the UPLC helix method after release the glycans and the labeling. This will add us a domain-specific glycosylation. However, there's a third strategy, which is to use the LCMS analysis of a digested N-glycan peptide. That will provide us with a site-specific N-glycan. So compare these three methods, we feel using the first one and the third one will cover everything. The middle one is kind of in between. So I'm going to show this slide. It's the UPLC helix analysis of released glycans. The top control gram is the peaks were identified based on the glycan library, IgG glycan library. So you can see we're only able to identify the regular 8 peaks, the G0, G0F, G1F on the traditional IgG glycan species. There's many unknown peaks which didn't present in the ID library standard. But with the online mass spec analysis, we were able to identify 22 glycan species. Also, for some species like the MAP5, based on the standard, actually contains another species in that peak. It's the G1F monoclonal. So these two species have different mass, but they co-rotate as one peak in the control grams. So mass spec analysis with the helix eliminates ambiguity arises from using just retained time of the standard and also identify unknown peaks that are not present in the library. With the LCMS analysis of glycan peptides, we're able to get the glycosylation profile of the three glycosylation sites. So the cartoon shows in each figure is the most abundant form of the glycans. As you can see from here, the three glycosylation sites in this molecule have quite a different glycosylation profiles. If we just use the UPLC helix method to analyze the pooled glycans, we won't be able to get this kind of information. And some of these glycan species can potentially related to its efficacy and or safety, and it's critical to monitoring this kind of detailed information. So next example, I'm going to show how mass spec helped develop method to monitoring methionine oxidation. So the top panel show here is the CEX analysis of TBSP and the photostressed samples. As the red arrow pointed out, we can see after stress, there's a post-solute peak increased in the analysis. And the data indicating that the photostress generates a slightly higher level of oxidation than TBSD. However, when analyzed the same sample using mass spec with peptomapping, the result revealed that the TBSP stress actually induce a much higher level of oxidation, which shows the result shows on the bottom panel here. The green bar is the sample stressed by TBSP, and the red bar is the photostressed sample. So obviously, CEX is not a properly method to monitoring methionine oxidation. So we need to develop a properly method. the first approach we took is reduce the antibody with the DTT to generate the light chain inhibition, then separate them using reverse phase. As the, so the chromatogram here, we can see the light chain is only one peak in the stress sample and the control. For the heavy chain peaks, after stressing with the increased time of the stress, the heavy chain peak was eluted around 20 minutes is decreasing, while there's a pre-heavy chain peak is increasing. Just based on this data, it looks like this reverse phase method is a good method to monitoring methionine oxidation. However, when we did the peak ID using mass spec, we found out in the heavy chain peaks of the stressed sample, they also have a mass plus 16 plus 32. In other words, the separation is not totally based on the oxidation of the methionine residues. So the this reverse phase method is not accurate to monitoring oxidation. Next, we took approach using RDS digest the antibodies, then reduce the sample. That will generate two copies of light chain, the FEB portion of the heavy chain and the FD portion of the heavy chain. This digestion process is simple, quick, and robust compared to traditional peptomethane method. And as shown here with the reverse phase separation, we can separate all the fragments well, and the peaks identified based on mass spec. So you can see in the red box here, with the stress, increased stress, the oxidized FEB portion of the antibody is increasing, and the original FD fragments have no mass increase. In the green box on the left side, we also detect the oxidation of the FD region of the heavy chain. So by using this method, we were able to accurate monitoring oxidation both in the FEB region and the FD region of the molecule. So this method also is QC friendly and can be used as a release method for monitoring methionine oxidation. In the fifth example, I'm going to show how mass spec helped to develop a properly formulation for antibody. So in formulation studies, we often do stability studies. The top panel shown here is the peptomethane overlay of two samples in formulation A. The pink trace is a control sample, and the blue trace is accelerated stability samples. As you can see from the chromatograms, a peak eluted around 96 minutes, corresponds to heavy chain 44 to 64. In the stability sample, reduced about 50%. And there's a new peak eluted around 90 minutes, showed in the stability samples. Mass spec identified that the peak is heavy chain 44 to 51, with the C-terminal side as amide. So this indicating there's oxidation and cleavage happened on the molecule during stability in formulation A. In comparison, in formulation B, the stability sample is almost identical to the control sample. So in other words, the formulation B can help prevent the molecule from this cleavage oxidation. So based on the literature, we know tryptophan can catalyze light to oxidize the water and generate hydrogen peroxide. That will cause oxidation of the proteins. Then we did a stress study to test whether we observed in real-time stability is due to this light stress. So after light stress, we analyzed sample using peptomethane. To our surprise, the light stress not only caused the tryptophan 52 oxidation, but also reduced a significant amount of methionine oxidation. Also, another difference we observed is among the different formulations, we didn't detect much difference when stressed with light. This tells us that light stress caused this tryptophan catalyzed oxygen water pathway probably is not the major degradation pathway for our molecule in formulation A. Then we also did a metal sparking study. So we sparked the sample with copper, zinc, and iron, and then analyzed the sample using intact LCMS. This is because intact LCMS analysis is faster. As you can see from here on the left side, the top two panels with the copper, zinc, the profile of the molecule is still very comparable to the one with the in formulation B, which the one didn't change. On the left side bottom is the sample spiked with the iron. That generates a very comparable profile to the sample from the stability in formulation A. So this result tells us that the trace amount of metal iron in the sample probably caused the oxidation and the cleavage in formulation A during stability, while formulation B can prevent these damages. So basically, after tryptophan were oxidized, it will cleave the peptide called the alpha amidation pathway and generate the N-terminal of the peptide ending with the amide. This matched very well with our peptide-mapping results. The 44 to 51 residue is ended with the amide in the peptide-mapping analysis. So the last example I have here is using mass spec to help characterize CESDF variants. So CESDF is a routine method used to characterize the size heterogeneity of monoclonal antibodies. For the reduced CESDF, you will detect real cleavage fragments of the molecules. The trace sold here, the red trace sold here is a control sample, and the black trace is a stressed sample. As you can see, in addition to the peaks observed in the control sample, the stressed sample showed quite a few additional peaks. These peaks, we believe, based on their size, probably due to fragments of the molecule. The problem is how to characterize these variants, because CE analysis uses a very amount of sample, and it's also very difficult to collect fractions. As I mentioned earlier, reverse phase LCMS is routinely used to characterize cell heterogeneity of antibodies. The picture showed here is the overlay of the stressed sample and the control. We did identify the several fragments which were labeled with the red numbers. However, since the reverse phase will separate the antibody based on their hydrophobicity, not based on the size, it's not straightforward to correlate them back to the CESDF results. On the other hand, SEC analysis and denature conditions can separate the molecule based on their size, and also able to couple with the mass spec to do online analysis. So with here, I showed top panel the reverse phase analysis of the two samples, and the bottom is the previously showed C results. So from here, we can see the results correlate pretty well. For example, the peak group 7, which is a group of peaks smaller than the light chain, are corresponding to the group of peak A in the CE, which is migrated before than the light chain peaks. In between the heavy chain and the light chain peak, there's three peaks in the SEC analysis, and there's four or five peaks in the CE analysis. So in general, they correlate the profiles much easier to correlate with each other in this analysis. On top of that, the FEC ESI MS analysis can identify all these peaks just based on their actual mass, or further can be confirmed using top-down approach. For example, in the peak group 7, after deconvolute, we're able to identify there are two groups of peptides or proteins in this peak. So the first group is on the left side, corresponds to the C-terminal fragments of the heavy chain with the cleavage around the residue 330. And the other set of the peak corresponds to the cleavage at residue 30, but it's N-terminal fragments of that cleavage. So this slide shows the components in peak 3. Again, there are two groups of fragments. There's one of them corresponds to the C-terminal peptide with a cleavage around residue 140. Another set corresponds to the N-terminal fragments with a cleavage at residue 330. So basically, peak 3 and peak 7 are pairs of due to a cleavage around 140 and 330 in the heavy chain. So this SEC-MS analysis is the first convincing method. There's no need to collect fractions. And also can be a platform method since it uses orthochromatic elution. So the method development time per molecule is significantly reduced. It's orthogonal to CSDS analysis and complementary to a reverse phase of the MS. So to summary, extended catalysis is extremely valuable in eliciting the structure of therapeutic proteins. So a variety of MS-based techniques are frequently employed to characterize therapeutic proteins. MS in combination with modern separation technology is essentially valuable in assessing the purity and structural identity of the protein because of its excellent specificity, sensitivity, and resolution. MS-based catalysis provides invaluable information in cell line upstream, downstream process. So with that, I want to thank my colleagues in Merck Bioprocess Development Department and Merck Biological Discoveries. Please hold your questions at, as Sarah said earlier. We will have a question-answer session at the end of the presentation. Now I'm going to pass the ball to Dr. Shion, and she's going to continue the webinar. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Xu. I'm Henry Shion. I'm very happy to be here today to present some of the work we did for InfluxMap Bio seminars. Thanks to Shreya as well for the early introduction. In Dr. Xu's presentation, he gave a very nice overview of the important role of mass spec plays in clone selection optimization of fermentation conditions, development of purification, and the formulation process. That's what I just wrote down in the process. For me today, in my presentation, I'm going to talk about biosimilars. Using FlexMap Innovator and the biosimilar as a study case and focused on LC-MS analysis of the critical quality attributes to do the demonstration of the biosimilarity of those two sets of samples. So what is biosimilar? What the definition for biosimilarity according to FDA section 351 is that the biological product is highly similar to the reference product, and there are no clinically meaningful differences between the biological product and the reference product. In terms of the safety, purity, and potency of the product. This is a slide that I took from the FDA presentation about 3 years ago from the WCPB meeting in Washington, D.C. As you can see from the presentation, the analyticals for the biosimilar process, development process is very, very important. There are similar guidance as well issued by the European Medicinal Agency for biosimilar development. So what are the challenges for biosimilar development? First, it is important to understand the innovators. If there's no in-house knowledge, the innovators need to be very well characterized and develop assets to monitor critical quality attributes, assess to the 3 years of batch variabilities, and also, of course, set up the specifications for biosimilar, and then design the biosimilar to try to match the innovator specifications. In that process, monitoring CQAs and stability and degradation, preclinical bioassays, high order structure, and wholesale protein profiling, all those characterizations, it's very important. In terms of critical quality attributes, they may contain the primary structure, PTMs, post-translation modifications, and chemical modifications, vessel bomb analysis, glycosylation patterns, aggregation, charge variants, so wholesale protein and protein conformation. All those attributes would have an impact in the efficacy of the drug, immunogenicity, and the ADM properties, as well as the shell storage stability. What is, as a company, we provide tools to allow customers to make measurements of all those CQAs listed on the left. In today's presentation, I'm focused on utilizing one platform solution. It's called Biopharmaceutical Platform Solution with Unify to describe all the experiment. At Waters, we have developed one integrated biopharmaceutical platform solution with Unify scientific information system to support the biotherapeutics development to analyze the key primary structure attributes. The system contains a listing here as the QTH class bio system, the 0G2S or XS QTOF system, and with the Unify informatics solution. This solution is a high-resolution analytical solution. It's in a network architect structure, which is very unique to Waters. This solution supports both compliant and non-compliant environment, and it can be deployed across the whole organization from discovery with few compliant issues to the QC release test where regulatory compliance is required. So, we'll use a case study where we establish compatibility of a candidate biosimilar InfluxMap against the innovator InfluxMap. As you know, InfluxMap is a blockbuster drug with 9.2 billion sales globally about a year ago. So what is InfluxMap? InfluxMap, the brand name from J&J is called Remicade. It's a 150K glycosylated chimeric IgG1 antibody with lysine variants. Remicade is a TNF blocker to use treat Crohn's disease and rheumatoid arthritis. So about 2.5 years ago, two forms of biosimilars were approved in EU market. Following that, there biosimilars of infliximab approved in other countries as well. It is expected that the biosimilar of infliximab will be approved in the U.S. in 2016. So to talk about the biosimilar of infliximab today is very timely. In our study, we used three batches of innovator infliximab from urine cell line, and we used three batches of candidate biosimilar infliximab. Those are from the CHO cell line. Regulatory approval for biosimilar product, as we know, is based upon its compatibility to an innovative product. So we developed an analytical workflow, core requirements that we have to characterize the candidate biosimilar and innovative infliximab as described, as shown in the slides. The workflow includes methods for characterization of primary structure and high-order structure, post-translation modification, glycosylation, size, and charge varying characterization. So, move on the intact meta-analysis. The conformation of primary structure is the cornerstone in the verification of the identity of a candidate biosimilar as infliximab. The first step is to assess an intact mass level. We use an LC-MS platform with Unified Informatics. In this slide, it shows a mirror image plot from Unify, compare one of the innovators and one of the biosimilars in the intact mass level. On the top in black is the innovator, deconvoluted intact spectrum, and the bottom is the biosimilar spectrum. And the masses between those two matched very well. But the profile, you can see they're quite different. The lysine variant differences in different levels we can see, and also the glycosylation variants in here. If we remove the glycoforms and the antibody, just compare or try to compare the C-terminal lysine variants, that's what we plot in here. You can see that the C-terminal variants between innovator and the biosimilar candidates, they are also very different. That difference can be quantified automatically in the Unify workflow. And here shows that the six batch of samples, three batches of innovator and three batches of biosimilars, in a trending plot in here, in a bar chart format. For each of the samples, we have done done three injections. Now, if we use carboxypeptidase B to treat the samples and remove the C-terminals, C-terminal lysines, so get rid of C-terminal lysine variants, we can compare solely the difference of the glycosylation on the antibodies. And here is the plot of the convoluted intact data again. And again, the mass matches very well, but the profiles are different. The difference, again, can be automatically quantified. And this showing that chart in here is showing the zero lysine variant form in all six samples, the relative abundance within itself. So that can be easily plot through the process. So we confirmed in the intact mass level, the biosimilars and the innovators, the very the mass matches. And we can reduce the sample, and light chain, heavy chain, just look at the those two forms separately. Here's the plot for the light chain, the light chain of the antibodies. And if you look at it, the convoluted spectrum on the right in here, there's no difference. This confirms the light chain are the same for both for between the biosimilar and innovator infliximab. However, if we look at the heavy chain just by itself, mirror image again in here, we see quite a difference. So the the masses, the match very well, but we see the lysine variant differences in here, and also the glycoform variant difference in here. So this experiment showing that the variants really just occurred in the heavy chain for the infliximab. And if we, using the same approach as in intact mass analysis level, remove the glycoforms, and we can just compare the difference between difference of the lysine variants. And on the right in here, see the difference. So, intact mass analysis of infliximab through different experiments, in the intact level, or the intact, the decarboxylated intact, and intact removed lysine variants. And also, we did heavy chain, light chain analysis, and also we did the decarboxylated heavy chain analysis. This show that the candidate biosimilar masses are consistent with the innovator biosimilar, but with different relative abundance of both glycoforms and lysine variants. We'll move to the peptide mapping experiment. For the peptide mapping experiment, what we want to see, first, we want to see if the candidate biosimilar protein sequence is consistent with innovator sequence. Second, we want to see if the candidate biosimilar N-terminal sequence is consistent with the innovator sequence. The N-terminal sequence is an integrate requirement of the ICH Q6B guidelines, as you may know. Third, we want to see if there's any post-translation modifications and what their relative quantity for those modifications. We did reduced peptide mapping experiment, and we also did non-reduced peptide mapping experiment to map the disulfide bond. Here's some data showing that the reduced peptide mapping from the reduced peptide mapping experiment. LCMS TIC chromatogram comparison in here shows very similar profiles. And if we look, you may not be able to see it carefully, but from the light chain sequence coverage and heavy chain sequence coverage, and the innovator and the biosimilar, they're identical. More importantly, the N-terminal sequence of both chains are confirmed by MS-MS experiment. And here shows the example, the MS-MS spectral comparison between the two sets of data. So you can see a very good MS-MS fragmentation generated through the experiment, and they're very identical in terms of the sequence and fragmentation patterns. So this is the confirmation of the sequence similarity. How about post-translation modifications? And this is an example of the oxidation modification in the heavy chain peptides T42. And the quantity of the modification with this peptide is automatically calculated in the unified data processing process. And what we found is about 50% difference between the innovator and the biosimilars, and the biosimilar has a higher percentage of oxidation. The other example for modification is the esterization of aspartic acid. This is an example from the peptide T24 in the heavy chain. What we found is that even though the esterization on both samples, they're very low. One is at 0.2% level, one is at 0.1% level, but they still can be accurately quantified. So in this example, it shows that LCMS is essential because the optical detection may not be able to detect at this kind of level. Again, the relative percentage of the modification, it's done automatically. This is a very important attribute to monitor because the azo aspartic acid is not a naturally occurred amino acid and can potentially be immunogenic. Move to the non-reduced peptide mapping experiment, and this is view from the review panel of the unified software after the data automatically acquired and processed. Using a single filter, we can extract only disulfide bond displayed in the component table in here. By all eight expected disulfide bonds were found from this experiment for both the innovator and the biosimilars. All the disulfide bond peptides are confirmed by the MS data showing here. Another benefit to use this platform solution I have not mentioned clearly is that the data is automatically applied, processed, and also reported. And this is one of the examples we do reporting here. We have the analysis information from the experiment in here. On the right up here, we have the component plot for all the disulfide bonds showing the mass in the mass range in here. And also with the component summary table displayed. In the table, it contains everything you would like to know for the disulfide bond peptides. It has the component name, the retention time of the peptides, the molecular weight, and the mass accuracy, the sequence, the response in intensity, and also the MS-MS fragmentation B and Y ions used for the conformation of those disulfide bond peptides. Let's move on to glycosylation analysis. Release glycan analysis is very important. And here's the simple workflow we use. And we do the glycosylation, and we label the glycans, which in this study, we use 2AB labeling. And then we purify the glycans and inject the samples into the LC fluorescence MS detection system, and using Unify for automatic data acquisition, processing, and reporting. And the experiment result is searched against a glycan database built into the Unify system. So everything is done automatically after sample preparation. The identification is used for the by the GU value from the separation, and the confirmation is used by the mass spec, mass accuracy from the mass assignment. Here is the fluorescence detection chromatogram comparison between the one of the innovator, one of by similar samples, and obviously you can see they're very, very different. It is not a surprise because they are from two different cell lines. What's interesting is that we found for the innovator samples, we identified altogether 26 unique released glycan species and 18 released unique glycan species in the biosimilar samples. And also, we also found that the innovator has several sialic acid containing glycans and also a low level of 1,3 alpha-gal glycan. As we know, alpha-gal is a potential immunogenic glycan. If we look at the sample in different form right here, you can see there are very little similarity of the glycoforms formed for those two sets of samples. And on the right, in the bar chart, and it's showing that the innovator has a high level of sialic acid containing glycans. And this slide shows that in the biosimilar samples, we found none alpha-gal containing glycans. In contrast, for the innovator sample batches, we found about 1% alpha-gal in all the samples. For aggregation analysis, we used the SEC TUV detection, and here plus the its overlay plot of the chromatogram of the innovator and biosimilar samples. What you can see immediately is that the dimer, the aggregates from the biosimilar is much higher than the innovator. In this case, the biosimilar is in red, if you can still see it. And that difference can be quantified automatically in the process. The plot in here shows that the innovator has about maybe 0.5% of the aggregation across all three samples. And for the biosimilar, it has about 5% in average, but very different. The actual number is showing in this table in here. So the biosimilar has about 10% more of aggregation than the innovator samples. It also shows that the biosimilar sample, they're very heterogeneous for the storage on the shelf, and that could be also an issue as well. Finally, for the charge variant analysis, we use the ion exchange experiment. In here, it shows the charge variant, they're very different. It's more mainly because of the C-terminal difference between those two sets of samples. As you know, that charge variance arises from post-translation modifications such as deamidation, sialization, and in complete process of C-terminal variance. In this case, it's very obvious. And MS data suggests major charge variance from C-terminal variance as we've seen before. So the difference, again, can be easily quantified automatically in the process. Using the zero-containing form in the experiment, we can do this plot in this next slide in here. Across all the samples, each sample has three injections, as you can see in here. The trending plot is showing the relative percentage of this chart, this variant, in the IEX experiment. Interestingly, if we plot the intact meta-analysis act the correlation, so the difference for among the samples will be only the C-terminal lysine difference will plot relative percentage of the contents right in here. You can see the trending of those two plots, they're very, very similar. As in Dr. Xu's presentation, we all know that orthogonal methods comparison in antibody development is very, very important for the agency to see. So this is one of the example, again, that all those plots can be plotted automatically and quantified automatically, and it's very, very useful. Now, if we look at the acidic variance across the sample for those two sets of samples, and we can calculate under different peaks the relative percentage of those peak areas. And listing here, we can see is that the biosimilar has a higher acidic variance in from the IEX experiment. The data I'm not showing in this presentation is that we actually did the fraction collection for those peaks and the peptide mapping experiment for those fractions, and we did pinpoint certain modifications of certain peptides for this acidic variance from the IEX experiment. So this is the last slide for me. In summary, what is development of analytical technologies and informatics tools for biotherapeutics development have enabled efficient characterization of both innovator and candidate biosimilar in FlexMap. The described workflow assess primary structure, sequence, PTMs, glycosylation, disulfobond linkage pattern, aggregation and charge varying similarities between innovator and the candidate biosimilar in FlexMap using a common analytical platform. It's called biopharmaceutical platform solution with Unify. And this case study is very comprehensive and is illustrated through the platform. With what is biopharmaceutical platform solution with Unify, we can do automatic data process acquisition, data processing, and reporting. This empowers the biotherapeutical and biosimilar development process and improve its efficiency and make it more quickly, optimize the method, and it potentially reduced the time of the drug development for the drug to the market. I want to thank my colleagues who worked on this project. Fish and I worked very hard and put this presentation together, as this did a very good job. Robert worked on the IEX data sets. Vera worked on the reduced peptide mapping experiment, and Inchin provide the release glycan analysis data, and Vivian oversee the whole project of this study. And I want to thank you for your attention at this point. If you have any questions, you're welcome to ask.
Thank you very much, Dr. Shion. So at this point, I'd like to begin the question and answer session. Just as a reminder, if anyone wants to ask any questions, there's a questions tab located at the top of the screen. If you click on that, you can add your questions there. So the first question I have is, this was asked during Dr. Xu's presentation, so maybe directed at him, but both of you can answer if you feel like you've got something to contribute. Let's have a look. What is the mobile phase for SEC-LCMS?
Yeah, so for that The example I show here is the mobile fish use formic acid and the TFA as a modifier, and acetonitrile and impropanol is the organic fish to a gradient leucines, acid-corrected leucines.
Okay, great. And the next question, again, this was asked during Dr. Xu's section. In the example in which lysine variant correlated with amidated species, was the approximately 10% amidated species detected in the HCMW of the reduced MW?
Yeah, that's a good question. For this example, we didn't detect a significant difference between the two samples for the C-terminal lysine LA-MIDE variants. Theoretically, we should. The thing I think is because maybe the conditions that have a different analysis season. But in the peptide mapping, it's very clear, and that can be confirmed by MSMS.
Thank you. The next one was asked during Dr. Shion's section. What strategies do you use to achieve the highest sequence coverage?
For normal peptide mapping experiment, what the strategy what you use to have the highest sequence variant sequence coverage, it could be that you use multiple enzyme digestion to have different ways to chop the protein into different peptide form. In our study, what I'm showing in the presentation, it's just triptych digest data. It's about 96 to 94% coverage with 2 to 3 MSMS fragmentation for the conformation of each peptide. But we did run other experiment with different enzymatic digestion and also sometimes multiple digestion. So we didn't show this data, but those data did confirm that the sequence of the biosimilar and the innovator in FlexMap, we were studying they are the same.
Great, thank you. The next question, have you performed HCP and HDX analysis on these samples? And I think that was directed, well, it doesn't say, but
I can answer that question. So for our InFlexMap biosimilar study project, the candidate samples we had before we stopped at this point whatever data present today. However, the project continues with the new biosimilar samples. That's actually in Flexra, the biosimilar sample currently on the EU market. So we're doing additional study, including the HDX experiment and HCP experiment, to compare those two sets of samples. And those studies, some of the results had already presented this year in the WCPB meeting in Washington, D.C. last week, and some of those works will be presented in the coming ASMS meeting. So the answer is yes.
Great. This one's directed at Wei, Dr. Xu. Could you share your thoughts on the following general question on MAB oxidation? What is the minimum level of trace metals peroxide that not impacting MAB oxidation or degradation to improve yield at upstream and downstream?
Yeah, so for the level, absolute level, I don't have numbers, but I think you know that's also depending on different molecules. So when we use two testing is for each molecule, we do called the four-step study between sparking the metal or peroxide to the sample at different levels and test how they are, sensitive to these stress conditions, and take a properly formulation to compensate for that.
Okay, and just following in from that, is there a specific example by how much the MAB purity reduced because of the peroxide trace metals? And is there a correlation between MW of the MAB and the oxidation?
Yeah, in general, there's no direct correlation, because that's because, if the oxidized MABs, it's difficult to get rid of during the process, purification process. As I mentioned earlier, the CF of silicon usually the first step of protein purification only about distinct them out. So normally they just carry over to the product. For that specific example, I saw the obviously with formulation A, there's a big impact because the peptide was cleaved after oxidation, and that's definitely affecting the purities.
Great. The next question is for both speakers. What pros and cons of nanoflow? What are the pros and cons of nanoflow versus microflow UPLC system in your LCMS analysis, and which is preferred?
This is Henry Shaw. For microflow, the potential, or for nanoflow, the potential benefit is the sensitivity for certain samples. That's because you have a low flow rate and a desolation, everything like the ionization process could potentially help in that end. However, from my study, what I feel that is the routine analysis is necessary for the development and for the whole drug process. And the efficiency is very important for every company, and the robustness of the methods of the whole system. And so what we used, it's very applicable and adaptable to any other similar settings in the process. So if I would say the pros on the higher flow rate system would be more overcome the benefit of the sensitivity end. What do you say, Dr. Xu?
Yeah, I agree with Sean's opinion. I think in the industry, especially close to the GMP labs, they want more robustness. So also in the labs, mainly the regular LC system, macro flow system. So the nano system is normally have a limited use. They only for kind of for special experience or do a investigation in the research labs. Definitely with the nanoflow, you're going to improve the sensitivity with the mass spec. That's for sure. But in situations where you have a limited amount of samples or characterize the low abundance species, that helps. But the majority of the work was done regular UPLC. Another advantage for the UPLC, the high flow rate, is you can increase the flow rate and speed up the process. So for example, the pyrometine, three, 4 years ago, we run over 2 hours per sample. Now it's just down to 15 minutes. In some special cases, we even pin down to 15, 20 minutes. So that's just to help improve the throughput. Also, in most of the cases, we don't limit it by the amount of samples.
Okay, thank you. Unfortunately, that's all the time we have. So any questions that have not been addressed here live will be answered via email. I would like to take this opportunity to thank our presenters, Dr. Wei Xu and Dr. Henry Shion, for sharing their knowledge with us. Audiences can view this webinar on demand by visiting biopharma-asia.com. Thank you, everyone.
Thank you.
Thank you, everyone.